Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much, Lori Jean. Thank you for breakfast. It's a great place. And I commend all of you for getting up early just for this. Boy, you're devoted.
Not for this, for you.
For you.
Thank you. So, how can I help you? How can I answer? Like, is anyone awake enough for a question?
I can be awake enough. I need to know every single thing in interaction with. Townsend, call me, then you can remember.
And go. He's so cute. First of all, he's very cute. Okay.
Don't I know it? He's very charming.
He what?
He's very charming. Like, his personality, like, as a person.
He is very charming.
Yeah.
And he's genuinely nice. You know, he's not just fake nice, like me. He's really nice. Very sweet. Yeah?
It's a question. So, like, now cartoons are really different than they were back then in status, right? Like, there's networks of cartoons, etc. So you were going to be a stage actress primarily. So my question is, was there like a weird stigma or like a context or a sense of like voiceover work wasn't really as, was there like a, like, what was the context of approaching voiceover work when you were going to do the voice of the Zacks?
Okay, so you're kind of asking, is there a strata of,
kind of, yeah,
acting?
Or just even when you were considering, yes, getting into voiceover,
right,
was that considered at that time, like, so, oh, that's going to be my profession, or just like something I do extra for a paycheck, kind of?
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
I think of acting as acting. In my mind, I don't segregate it and say, oh, I'm a voice actor, or I'm on camera, or I am stage. I have done it all. Except porn. But there is still time. So, you know, basically, that's what I think. And I approach off-camera acting as if I am on camera. There's just no camera, which is great, because you can do off-camera in your pajamas, which makes it so much easier in many respects. I almost wanted to go like, oh, I wish you guys were all sitting on one side so that I wasn't like not seeing someone.
Can you
come all the way over here? Because I don't want to miss my key light.
Oh.
If there is one. And then we can do even this and make this such this is so groovy. I had to bring it in because it's larger than like much of the so I can look. Yeah, I won't. Yeah, right. I'm going right here. Thank you, guys. The question. So, no, I don't think, there you are. I don't think of it as separate at all.
But to the industry, though.
In the industry, yes. I believe there are people who think that, voice work is less than. What they don't know is that that's not true. So you've got different echelons. And here's the thing. When I was doing voice work, it was still considered that sort of like, oh, a little bit less than. Within 2 years, that was over. Because now you couldn't get a job because they chose names in order to do, yet again, 90%. You know, it's that like top percent that does 90% of the work, and then everybody else, you know, the grunt workers who do it. So it just became very, it was very changed. And we knew that. We knew in the 80s that it was the last golden era for lesser known actors to do voice work because it was starting to become an even smaller niche to break into. Because you had Frank Welker, you know, Frank. Beautiful voice, you know, you have a lot of people who I felt like put their stake in the ground. That was their mountain. They don't want anybody on. So, wonderful people and very close group, tiny group. Did that answer?
Yeah,
no,
it's interesting.
Oh, good. Mm-hmm. Great. Okay, are we done?
Sorry, wait. Okay, Kleenex.
Uh-oh, why my nose run, I'm so cold. Oh, yeah.
It's a napkin.
Perfect.
I'm tied up in this camera.
This is so perfect and so disaster.
That is.
I'm going to go behind my,
You can even, like, duck behind there.
Yeah.
So you can be deep. It's a leg show. It's a leg show. Da 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 da.
Woo! It is cold. It is chilly.
I got three shirts on. What about you guys?
I slept in like three shirts. Like I slept in a like pajamas, a hoodie, and a sweater. That
yes.
was on Friday though.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a lot, even for a girl from Toronto or Montreal or wherever it snows. Yeah. Yeah. Cool. Any other deep questions? Yes.
It's not deep, but.
Service.
Well, what was your favorite line that was asked?
Oh, shut up, pig face. I mean, how can you top that? Except. Oh, don't ever call me Phyllis. Great. Yeah. Like those. Yes, ma'am.
So, I know that the voice actor of the actors had done various characters, but I don't know it well enough to know who else besides Pizzazz.
Oh, and I don't know that either. Excuse me, I'm gonna do this.
Were you only Pizzazz?
No, I was not. I was many little girls. Many.
She could hear it.
Yes, of course she could. She could
hear it. And she's like,
yes, that's right. She's right. She's absolutely right.
In hindsight, I don't know.
Yes.
One of them is Terry, I think.
Terry,
the scaredy cat girl. The scaredy cat girl in the Halloween episode.
Was I bad?
She was real nerdy.
She's nerdy, of course.
So, you know.
But my inner intellectual one. No, we did that a lot, where we would just fill in and be extra voices. And I remember one episode, this is not what you asked, but there was one episode, and Samantha couldn't be there with us that day to record. So Wally says,
I'm going to read Sam's part too.
I'm like, okay. So I'll be Sam, and I'll be Sam's, okay. Well, I tell you, at the end of that day, I had never been so tired in my whole life because now Wally's directing me as if I'm Sam. Like, get on it, put a little more of that, get on it. I'm like, argh! And I'm like talking to myself with full energy the whole time. And you know, working with Wally, some of you know or may not know, he was a real stickler for getting the line readings exactly as he wanted them with full energetic delivery. Very different from working at like Hanna-Barbera, much different. So, you know, I was just like, but Wally, it's me. Why do I have to do this? I'm not Sam, you're gonna record her, you know, put her in over this one. Oh my goodness, I was wasted. Just exhausted, you know, thinking, you know, oh, my poor life, I had to work one day. Sorry. Yes, dear.
Yeah, did you sit around the table and like do the script as contractors, or did you do like, all your lines and somebody else? Did you really interact with each other?
No, good question. We worked ensemble, and actually we did sit around the table. We would have an initial run through. And so that's when we would all see the storyboard, because there weren't individual storyboards on our scripts like sometimes would happen in other cartoons. So we would pass them around, we'd see what was going on, and he would explain, well, this is what's going on here and here. So we would all do a run through, and then we would usually separate, because there were usually three or four mics set up in the recording room. Well, control was watching, and so it was usually I was in there with, you know, Susan and Kathy, who well, she has a new name now.
Samantha.
Her name is Samantha, right?
Sam Paris.
What?
Sam Paris.
Yes, Sam Harris, but she had another name. And I had,
right now.
Charlie. Yeah, me and Charlie. Ooh, we had fun. So even if the four of us would be on mic, well, Jem and the holograms were in the other room, in the green room, and so we would come in shifts, unless it was an ensemble, and then we would all be hugging the mics, and you would pop in, and you would pop in on your mic.
And it would separate good people from the bad people.
Yes, exactly.
Was Charlie
Adler.
He was like Eric Raymond, right?
And Tech
Hot,
too.
Let's
not forget that.
Yeah. He was really very wonderful. It still is. And, oh my gosh, I don't know if any of you have been able to see. He has a little film out. Have you ever been able to see it? And he plays a 15-year-old tennis girl. But he looks like himself when he's like 45.
Oh my
God. With a skirt on. But it's all about, you know, gender issues and, you know, why do I feel different? Really different, but it's really done well, and I hope you can look it up, and I don't even know the name.
When was it made?
What?
When was this made?
This was made in the past, I think, 5 years.
Okay.
Oh. It's really, really interesting. If you just Google Charlie Adler film, short YouTube, I think it will come up, and he told me what it was. I forget. Sorry.
So are you still in touch with him?
It's rare, you know, it's like, it's so rare. It's like random, accidentally hit Charlie Adler's number. And
wow.
He goes, you're not going to leave this. I was just thinking of you. I never pick up the phone. And he doesn't. I said, John, how are you? What are you doing? Fine. So he's in New York, as far as I know, and still doing his life.
Wow.
Yeah.
Is there anyone that you keep in touch with regularly from the cast?
Well, Samantha.
Okay.
Yeah, Samantha and Louise Dorsey. I love Louise. I love Sam. And we all happen to live in Nashville, which is very unusual. Louise is very devoted to her sweet daughter. And Sam is, of course, all over and has to do Granite come on this weekend. Okay. She can go have the blocks. Yes.
Did you ever do the song before you performed it?
No.
That's an interesting question, right?
No, we never heard the music before.
Because your things would lead into the music.
You right.
Would respond to the music.
Yes. And we didn't even have the lyrics.
Whoa.
Wow. Weird.
No. It was sort of like, oh, this is what's happening. You know, it was just tiny stage directions. Yes. Oh, and because we were following a story, and usually the song would branch out on a piece of the story, but we were, you know, we had the whole story.
Did you ever meet the writers?
I don't remember ever meeting them.
You never met Christy?
Who?
Christy Marks.
I had not met her. I don't remember if I ever met her.
Really interesting.
Yes. Well, you know, we were also separated, and wasn't she? She was always working. She was writing. She didn't have time to come in and watch a recording because she's writing the next show, right?
I think, you know, that's interesting that you had your segment, and it was so successful. You knew. Like I said yesterday, I just saw a treatment. So we're writing the songs. It was like on a need to know basis.
Yes.
I didn't need to see the storyboard, and I didn't. You know, need to see all the dialogue. I just needed a treatment.
Right.
Go write the song. They didn't need the songs. They just needed the script.
Right.
And so and then it got all put together. It was great.
Right. Yeah. You have like, you know, two lines of description. You know, falls down. Breathing hard. Hurry, hurry, get there, girl. Something like that. Jock, what? Jock's head is really hurt.
Of
what?
Uncontrollable giggling during a recording session.
I still didn't get
that.
Uncontrollable giggling.
Uncontrollable
giggling.
Oh, did we have to do that?
No, like unplanned.
Unplanned?
Yes.
allowed to start over.
Yes, yes. Oh, yeah, we could start, we would get in trouble all the time. And yes, it would be uncontrollable giggling now and then, or usually, because we have children here, I would stumble over a line or something, and then I would have quite a spew of expletives that would sort of singe the poor recording engineer's ears. And, on and on. So, I was known for my extreme foul mouth, but I consider that essential to character building.
Yes. Wow. Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah. But boy, I could make truck drivers blush. Yes.
Was that a disaster? Was that one of the other actress that was worst case for Dickman?
What?
Was there any actor that was like the worst for like laughing? Prone to laughing, I guess.
Flubbing their lines.
not so much flubbing.
I mean, when you start digging and you look at someone and
you would just start laughing. You know, that would be such an inside job. But I remember I really loved Kathy Ann Blore, and but we weren't always in the same scene. She was pretty much opposite. But she's really, I just thought she was wonderful. And so sometimes I just look at her and start cracking up. No. Oh, by the way, Ellen.
Could you tell us a little bit more about Wally Burr, what else he did besides Jim, but also did you like working with him? And he you said he could give you the line readings exactly. Was he a very controlling director? Did you mind doing that? Did he allow you to do anything, on your own special?
Oh, yeah. I really loved and respected working with Wally. Because I hadn't done an abundance of cartoons up to that point, I did not know that it was unusual to spend a whole day recording a cartoon. And we could spend upwards of 4 to 6 hours. And that's what some of the other actors were very impatient about, like Charlie. They go, no, I got another appointment. I need to be in an hour. I have a commercial to do. So,
Jay Foyer, wasn't it?
Oh, absolutely. They could keep you all day. Yeah. And so they could, and they did. Yeah. But Wally, and I, he was so good. And I know he did the Transformers too, didn't he? And I have this vague recollection, and I don't know if I'm just imagining this or not, but did not James Earl Jones, did he do an episode for us?
I don't think so.
It was someone like him, though.
With Jeff?
Yeah, did he do a show?
I thought he did, Unicron or something to Transformers.
He did something, and I swear to goodness that I think I saw him one time, either coming in or out of the studio. I don't think I was, whoa, this is
I
could be totally wrong about that. But Wally certainly would give line readings if he wasn't getting what he wanted. He certainly allowed us to deliver our lines the first way that we were inclined to do that. But if he felt that there was something else and he wanted to get more, he wanted to hear something tougher, harder, he would go up there, and I could do 5 takes, but I remember doing 5 takes on Screamers.
How?
How? Yes, exactly. And that's why I say I would go home and you just sleep now and not talk to anyone.
Yeah.
Because I didn't fake scream. Of course not. I can't fake acting. Well, no. I'm serious. It's but some people are really good in. And they can kind of do fake acting and fake screams where this is a departure. I worked with Pierce Brosnan a couple times actually in, yes, thank you for my memory. And I remember, and this is what I learned from him, he's such a sweet and gracious man, and so was Stephanie, and Stephanie's in the list, they were so wonderful. And so he, remember, he was supposed to take a fall, right? I would take a fall like this. Oh, you know, and do all this stuff. And this is how he fell. He just sort of went. He just went out of the frame. Oh, like, you're not on the ground. I'm like, what? Hello? He just sort of drifted out of the frame. And he, you know, and I was like, wow. I thought, and he would sort of like gently crumble to the ground where I would like fall and flail like, you know, some spastic. Anyways, what was my point?
Sorry. Fake versus real.
What?
Fake, yeah. I just throw my whole self into it. I always have. Because I think because then it makes it more fun for me.
Yeah.
It's all about me. But that's not the voice from his hands, right? Just your real. Yes. Oh, two of you, okay.
Did you do any other voice work besides cartoons? Like, what I sometimes find interesting is watching a TV show or movie and somebody's mouth doesn't quite sync up to their voice and overdubbing.
Yes.
Did you ever have to dub for another actress?
I never dubbed, but I did Married with Children, and I did, I was an announcer, and I don't know if I was a parrot or not. You know, so I've done a few Married with Children, I've seen my off camera, and certainly other cartoons. I did a Snorks.
Oh, the Snorks! Oh.
Yes. Snorks.
Yes!
And I did, was Frank, not Frank, Tim Curry. I worked with Tim Curry.
What?
I could have been in Snorks.
I don't think I'm a huge, 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 huge Tim Curry fan, and I would know everything that he did in the 80s. I don't think he's ever done Snorks, but
well,
maybe, let me think, not Fern Gully.
Maybe he, no, it was not Fern Gully. I don't know if he did Yogi Bear. I did Yogi Bear.
Did you do Peter Pan
and
Pirates?
I did not.
He was.
I did not do Peter Pan. I did, Snorks, Batman, Yogi Bear. These are special guests, okay? And so, and maybe it was another one, I can't remember, but he came in. No. Okay. Like Yo Yo Ma.
It's so good.
Okay, I'm like, Tim Curry, my gosh. You know, my Rocky Horror Picture Show. And I'm thinking, he was just great. God, what a great voice. First of all, he's such that timbre in his voice. And he was dressed like, you know, like a really nice, crisp, like, button down shirt and like, pants that had that crease ironed in them, you know that? I'm like, wow. It's not like some slob. He's like dressed very nicely. Came in, worked professionally. And that was the thing. Well, we worked at Hanna-Barbera. I loved Hanna-Barbera. And I worked with Gordon Hunt. And I think Gordon is Helen Hunt's dad. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Is it John?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And wonderful director. And then later on, I worked with not Sue Blue, but her friend who worked with her, and I can't think of her name. Oh my gosh, Andrea Romano.
Yeah.
Okay, Andrea, really great. And Andrea and Sue Blue used to teach voiceover classes, and I had taken one or two of their stuff, you know. And Sue had written a book about voiceover acting. I'm digressing, and I can't remember where I was going with this. Oh, but here's the thing. So when we worked at Hanna-Barbera, we would be in and out of there within an hour. You would have a quick run-through. You would all be in ensemble while they're recording, and it would just be done. So quick.
Who directed that?
That was Gordon Hunt and or Andrea Romano.
Oh, those were the directors?
Yes. Uh-huh. Yes.
When you got a script, you got a script, right?
You get a full script, but you don't get the script until you show up.
Okay.
It's not like you get the script a day or two before. It's not like, you know,
like
soap opera.
It's like you're in a commercial. It's like you go in, like a single, like after Jingle Center, you go in, you just go in, that's when you learn it, that's when you do it, goodbye.
Exactly. Yes.
My question is, I think I touched on this yesterday, but writing songs of Pizzazz, you know, that this one, I don't know if you got the original treatment, which I did, about the little treatment, you know. Three pages.
Yeah.
And I said, this Pizzazz character is damaged. I mean, she's, you know, she's like a motherless, she's motherless too.
Yes.
And she's pretty much fatherless because her father just throws her a jacket and says, go play in traffic.
Yes.
She's abandoned. She doesn't really have a father.
Yes. She's the wounded antagonist. She is the agent of change.
Right.
Right?
That's right. I think it really makes sense that once we have Pizzazz, we can have Jim. We needed to know who the antagonist is.
Oh, you have to. You know, that's the classic, you know, hero's journey. I mean, we can't have the light without the dark. You have no shadow. You have no light without shadow. You have no shadow if there's no light. So we need it all. But we're such a culture that's we can't have it. It's like, I keep forgetting, although I am not one, we need warriors in the world, right?
I'm a warrior.
You are a warrior. Yeah. Okay, yeah. I'm a poet. You're a warrior.
Well, I'm also a fool. A warrior is a fool.
So, you know, and we are not just one thing. We are these different archetypes that will come and spring forward at times in our lives. And how we use them to be agents of change and to change ourselves so that perhaps we can climb the great spiral of life to perhaps something better. And I could go off on that for a while, but you know, we are in this garden together such a short time. I prefer flowers and bees, and some people want to use a lot of Monsanto products, you know. So how do we live together?
Right.
You know.
But I can hear in your voice, there's frustrations in that, but this was a person who really was talented and ambitious and wanted to be noticed. This frustration with someone.
Yes.
So you know that you must have taken in her wound.
Well, I had my own to come in.
I mean, right.
Right. And so I had a lot of own personal wounding, and I had not done a lot of therapy yet. So it was perfect. It was perfect.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yes. Garth.
I was going to say, when you said agent of change, that triggered something I saw in an episode recently, and it was great because it actually led into a song. It's the episode where the Misfits steal Jem's music, and then Pizzazz is about to record her own vocals on the Jem track. And the engineer in the studio says, "Are you ready to go, babes?" And then Pizzazz says, "We're not your babes." And I thought that was such a moment of, like, just that long ago, just kind of combating sexism, like, wow, that was like, okay, we're not your babes.
Yeah.
And then it led into her singing the song, "There Ain't Nobody Better." So I was like, oh, okay.
Wow. I have to tell you, I certainly remember that. But if the Zaz said, we're not your babes, right? I'll tell you that my whole life, growing up, from, you know, like early, you know, teenage on, I cannot stand it when a boyfriend would call me baby or babe. I hated it. And I don't know why, but I think I maybe feel like, oh, baby. And I don't want to feel like a babe. I want to feel like, you know, like a woman. Imagine that. You know, I just want to feel like me, not like this. You know, and I know it's like it can be an endearing, sweet thing, but for me it was like, I am not your babe. Mm-hmm. I am not. So, oh my gosh, if I ever said that. Babe, what do you want? Uproar by a few other active actors who were like, no, like this is a morning session, I need to be out. And I'm like, no, really, you're contracted for the whole day, you don't get to double book yourself. But most people were used to double booking themselves and thought they could until they found out they really couldn't. Yes, but you're there. 8 hours. If you go over, then you get overtime. And if you do stunts, ooh, stunt pay is really fun and helpful if you don't hurt yourself.
You have to do a stunt when you're doing voiceover.
No, only on camera. Yeah. Boy, I've done stunts.
I don't think a screen should have
that. Yeah, you don't hurt yourself too much off camera, except if you're screaming all day. I help you on the screen. And I
did.
Yes, squealing and screaming. We made pigs feel ashamed. They could never keep up with me. Sorry. Yes,
no, give us a scream.
Oh, I'll give you a scream. Oh, you'll get there. Okay.
Now you said you did stunts. I'm kind of curious. What kind of stunts?
Oh, I did a stunt for, I don't know, there's a movie that it was in called Midnight Madness. I don't know if anyone's seen it. And we were like five groups of college students, and we were on a treasure hunt all night long in Los Angeles. And again, I don't know how this happened, but I was cast as this antagonist. And my name was... Lucille. Lucille. And so I'm just like after my boyfriend the whole time. And my boyfriend was Steven Burst. And he was in Animal House, and then he was on sort of Star Trek things. And I was always nagging him about what he was eating. He wasn't supposed to be eating the things I thought he should be eating, doing the things I thought he should be doing. And Harold, stop it, Harold. So the whole thing, and so at the end of the thing, we have like a brunch, and he's going through the line, getting all his food. And I'm going, Harold, stop this. And we're at the Renaissance Hotel downtown in Los Angeles, and I'm standing in front of one of those fountains that's like about this high. And I get eggs in my face, and he pushes me backwards over into the fountain. And what I didn't know is inside the fountain, there is like this whole conduit of, you know, metal, this big round like pipe that's probably running filtration through it. And I had to clear the pipe in order to fall over backwards and you know, go down under. So I think it was I did the take, I think, two or three times. One of the takes, I went over and I hit my head, off cement, and I hit my head, and I remember like going, oh, but I couldn't complete my backwards roll, so my ass is in the air upside down. And the doctor on the set broke the scene and stepped in to, okay, I thought I'd knocked myself out, and I had, like, stand up, and I'm like, you know, dripping all these eggs and stuff on my mouth, but, you know, it was fun because, fortunately, I love water, and I like eggs. But, I mean, you can get some crabs on the steps, creepy, but I thought, well, I can do this. I can do my own stunt. This will be really fun and easy. And we made it work. We made it work, but not without a few
medical assistance.
Can't break a few eggs.
Yeah, we had a few bumps, a few eggs I brought home on my head. It was fun, fun. Yes.
Sounds like a lot of fun.
I have a question.
Yes.
Was there any show you worked on that you found was so engaging or so fun that you became a fan of the show itself, even though you were working on the show? And followed it perhaps after?
I must say, I usually did not watch the show afterwards. I'm a big hiker, and Saturday mornings, I would try to go out to the Angeles Crest and get out of Los Angeles to breathe a little fresh air. So that's where I would be. And it wasn't until I was home one summer, and I had like little cousins who had like, you know, those gem sleeping bags and stuff. And they're like, oh, they have gem sleeping bags and all this stuff. And I had no idea that there was even such things, you know. We just didn't know. Also, because we would record, so like we recorded mostly during the spring or throughout the year. But that show wouldn't be on until, you know, weeks, months later. And by then, life was radically changed for us as actors, so we're on to the next thing. Yes, dear?
So going back to Pizzazz, but from what you can recall, was there any scene that you were doing that either made you feel uncomfortable or you weren't sure? Like, it shocked you that they would put something like that into a cartoon?
I think, and I think I said this yesterday, I think when I had a line, shut up, pig face, people say that. I was shocked, but, you know, by then I was enough into it to say anything, and when I'm into something, I will say anything, obviously. And then I have to backtrack and clean up mess, but not enough because Pizzazz, she is just so fecund. You know, is there anything richer than an antagonist you can't help but want to be around and love and just get in there? You know, how perfect. I mean, licensed to be bad. Paid to be bad.
Did
whoa.
You,
now I can think of a whole new career for myself. Porn. No. Not a porn star. No.
Your porn name could be Yo-Yo Pa.
Yo-Yo Pa.
Yo-Yo Pa. Question.
Yeah.
I know that there was a cast launch party for the Gem Show with the voice actors.
There was?
Back in the day, there was. Samantha still has the invitation from that event. And when I saw it, Sister Sledge was the musical act that was performing at it.
I don't recall this at all. Okay. Are you sure that Pizzazz was invited? Because if I'm not, I have serious issue with this. Unless my memory's truly gone, which could be happening. I had no idea. I don't remember that.
Yeah, seeing it was just odd that Sister Sledge was the...
And they didn't invite you.
I don't think they did.
They didn't invite any of us.
Right.
No. See, this is definitely a conspiracy.
No, but it was all run by the Korean animators.
See? Yeah. There you go. Right. They have preferential treatment, those gym girls.
Patricia, I have a question.
Okay, I have an answer.
I maybe this has something tying into the invite, but I wonder if you have any familiarity with the cast jackets, how they were made.
Oh no!
This is
Great.
You are so lucky I don't have a weapon in my hand. I have no idea about this.
She's talking about the little ones from Integrity.
And I couldn't fit into?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Really?
Did they give you a jacket?
Did you buy a tiny jacket?
No, I didn't get a jacket for the show. We didn't get a new
thing. Sorry. Those little kids. Keep in mind my name. I don't remember such a apparel.
I believe what I understand is that they might have, they may not have given them, they may have offered them for sale, and I just wondered if you might have been in possession of one, or if you had any recollection of anything about it.
No, and no. I wish, yes, but no. You know, at the time, like I said, we had no idea that you guys would exist in our lives. I mean, you know. It's like, you know, just doing your job and having fun and best kids.
Didn't you think it was kind of, I've read some stories about that chosen people, older people who were involved in the MGM, like studio system, and, you know, in the 40s.
Yes.
And before we were in the
right, right. Yeah.
And they had a great time, and they worked like crazy.
Yes.
And it was highly professional.
Yes.
Well, I always felt like it was jingle business. Primarily, and also this show.
Yes.
We're like the studio business.
Yes.
We had top talent people.
That's right.
And the whole union was run a certain way. It was kind of as close as you could get to that studio system. We went to work every day doing original music. I mean, I don't think that truly exists anymore. And I wonder if, you know, you're kind of thinking, you said a lot of it's gone by, like Meryl Streep will read the lines, and you won't get that part. You know?
Right.
But I think that's what we had then, was kind of like the studio system figured out.
Yes.
For these shows.
Yes. I think it was like, we have like this, you have this core of actors that worked a lot, that your directors would call the agents to know, to say, I need so-and-so. I think they pulled from their pool because they knew they could count on them to deliver exactly what they need in a short amount of time. They didn't have time to wait for someone to not fulfill that role. But I remember one time going to LA Sound in Nashville, and I was in the waiting room, and there was Charlton Heston waiting to read for an audition. And I thought, Moses? In here? Has to audition? I wrote a whole poem about it. I was just like floored because I thought, Charlton Heston is still auditioning. And that just shocked me that someone of that caliber was working with the rest of us, you know.
You know who doesn't have to audition? Lawyers. You never have to audition. You don't have to do demos. You know, if it doesn't work out, well, okay, well, here's your bill. It doesn't matter, you know. With us, it's like, it's all a competition with you.
Yes,
audition.
Yes, yes.
About the people who got to pay the checks.
My time is up, and I want to thank everybody for that.